Let's get started. First of all, thank you all for showing up in a rainy day for the talk. And today I'm really excited to have Sean here. And I actually know Sean from grad school. And he does really, really interesting work in the intersection of personal informatics, self-tracking. And today he's going to talk about how to gain insight and experience through personal data. So Sean has graduated from University of Michigan School of Information in 2012. I think he has won the NSF Early Career Award and also the AHRQ, I think R21 grant. And he's now assistant professor at the Human-Centered Design Engineering Department at University of Washington. And I do want to mention that before today, in order to get a better sense of what Sean is doing, I checked his website. Wow, there's a lot of Chi and CSW papers this year. I lose track of how many are there. So there's a lot of really interesting work he's going to cover in today's talk. And I think I know that our graduate students are really excited to have him here. And hopefully we can learn, more people can learn from this talk today.
Thank you. And thanks for all coming out. I am very sorry to have brought the rain, though.
Seattle's treat, right?
And so to kind of set the groundwork for where my research focuses and what I try and do in it, we've reached a point where we have a lot of ways of collecting data about what we eat, what we do, various digital traces about our other activities, where we've been. My colleagues continue to make better and better and cheaper sensors for various things. And this creates a whole new opportunity, but the actual work itself for this line of tracking things about yourself is not that new. So it's actually a phenomenon, I believe, from the 1880s, a little more ornate than the ones that are out there now. And they've been around for a while. This is an Abercrombie and Fitch pedometer. You may not know that they had that business. And they went through some curious design phases. And they also spent time as sort of this cultural phenomenon. So this idea of Mbokai, which is we're all going to walk together, was one of the first mass-produced cheap pedometers. And you would see people out in Japan wearing it in very visible public places. You know, so the traffic directing, serving in a bar or on a plane, right? And so there's this cultural idea, too, if we're all going to walk together, right? And yeah, maybe some of us do this now digitally with our Fitbits, and we all see leaderboards online or things like that. Over time, pedometers got more capabilities. So this is the Omron, which has been used in a lot of clinical studies. It's also one of the very first pedometers that would upload automatically, at first through a serial port, then a USB port. I think they have a wireless one now. And the same basic idea underlies a lot of these, right? You get this. You want to track your physical activity level. It may not be something that you're very good at keeping track of or that's very visible to you. So you wear it as you go about your day. At some point in the day, you look at it. And you have some sort of reaction, which we are hoping is, oh gosh, I better get walking if you fall short of your goals or you find that you aren't walking as much as you think you are. And you get moving. Okay. And so Ian Lee, in his dissertation work, outlined this as sort of the personal informatics model. It consists of preparing, collecting, integrating the data, reflecting on it, and acting on it. All right. And so a story that he uses in one of their papers is someone named Alice. She's 20 years old, she has a family history of heart disease, wants to be more active, doesn't know how because she's got a lot going on in her life. So she looks at a bunch of different pedometers, picks a Fitbit because she thinks it will, you know, be something that she can wear more readily, and she likes the integration, she likes the flower. She also decides that she's going to keep track of what she's doing throughout her day in a notebook as she goes along so she can try and look for these opportunities to fit walking in her busy schedule. And so she does this, she graphs it over, or looks at the data over a week, and she identifies some inactive days and a more active day. And she says, well, maybe there's an opportunity here to adjust my behavior. What if on Sunday, instead of watching an entire season of House of Cards, I maybe go for a walk in the park and just watch 3 episodes or something like that, right? And so she's looking for these opportunities to adjust and hit her goals more consistently, right? And so this model, I think, is really good for kind of a data dependency model, right? You've got some preparation, and what you choose to prepare to collect and what you choose to collect affects what data you can later bring together and inspect and the opportunities that you're going to identify for action. But I think that as the model is presented and as it's been built in a lot of commercial systems, there's a whole lot of assumptions in the model that don't necessarily hold up well and that cause us to miss a bunch of design opportunities. Right. And so I think one of the first assumptions in it is that action is the goal, right? And so we kind of design personal informatics tools with this eye towards helping people act or change behavior. And so if we actually go back and ask people what their goals are, yeah, sure enough, actionable insights come out there as one of the top goals. But many people are also just curious, right? They're not necessarily trying to walk more. They just don't even know how much they do walk, and they wonder. Or they wonder what the places they visit most often are, or they wonder how they spend their time, or things like that. Other people just like having a record, right? And it's documentary tracking. Maybe it'll be useful for something later on. Maybe there's something comforting about having this archive of your data. Or maybe it'll help you spot problems later on. If you notice your health is starting to decline, you can go back and compare it to some baseline or something like that. Other people do this tracking to participate socially. So if you've used Foursquare or Swarm or whatever variation it's in now, you may have encountered this where it helps you share your location so that others can see. You don't actually care about the record or the history. You're not trying to change your behavior. You're trying to be more active and stay a little more connected to some of your friends, perhaps. Other people do it to collect rewards. So a number of insurance programs or workplace wellness programs now tell people, wear this pedometer, upload the data, and we'll give you some points. And those points might count towards reducing your deductible. They might be things that you can redeem for a gift card or something like that. Right? And so it's sort of unlocking these values. Same thing if you check in at Yelp, you're giving them your data. Maybe you're keeping track of your check-ins. You probably aren't, but you're getting a discount or something in return often. And other people really just like tracking, right? You know, they're curious about the new technology, they're curious about having this data, right? And this is actually a totally reasonable goal. So I asked at a previous talk some people what were their reasons to track, and one of the answers was, I just love the data, right? You know, this is a true thing. I think it's a little more true in our computer science-y circles than in the general population, but this is a goal that many people bring to it. Right. And so all of these goals end up with some different design needs that come out of it, or at least understanding as designers or researchers what goals we're trying to support. And it's maybe some of these, maybe it's not all of them in a given product. A second assumption that I think is pretty present is that people are going to use these tools indefinitely. Right. So if we go back to Alice's model where she's tracking, that walk in the park, now she's got to keep track of those as she goes forward. Maybe it becomes a routine, but for most people, it's kind of this ongoing, oh, I'm trying to hit this many steps. How am I doing this week? Is there an opportunity to do better? Where did I fall short? How can I adjust my behavior? But in fact, when we actually look at actual behavior with personal tracking devices, we see that a third of people abandon wearable trackers within 6 months. So that's things like Fitbits or pedometers, half within a year. And they give them up, right? You know, this isn't something that is necessarily easy for people to do or remember, or they don't get the value out of it that they wanted. Right, and so reasons that people lapse if we go out and we interview them or conduct surveys are it's high burden for collecting the data, right? So or just remembering to keep the device charged and worn. Or being confronted by one's data is also costly. So if you're someone who thinks of yourself as active and you find out that you're walking maybe 1,000 steps a day, this is really hard, right? And it turns out you have to say something like, oh, actually I've rationalized a lot of days away. And so it's just concerning. And other people are concerned about having this treasure trove of data around that could later be exploited, or that they feel like they're supposed to get more value out of than they actually are. And so it becomes this burden and they free themselves of it by stopping tracking. All right, so that's a more negative version of it. Other people stop because they've met their goals, right? And they think that they're on a steady path, and if they had a target weight and they were exercising to lose weight or watching their calories to lose weight, and they hit that, they might stop. They're done, right? Other people, will check in occasionally to see if they're doing okay at maintaining their goal or something else. Others are just curious, and once they find out how much they walk or where they go or how they spend their time, the effort to keep doing it doesn't outweigh the benefits they're getting anymore. And finally, other people just hope for more benefits than they actually get, right? And so one of the challenges is, I'll come back to it in a second, but one of the challenges is that people often turn to a Fitbit thinking that it will tell them how to be more active, not just how active they are, right? But all that number really is showing is how active you were today, and you get a graph and you can look at it over time. Right? And so one of the other research opportunities here is to design for lapsing and restarting, right? So what happens after someone stops? How do you help them come back to it? If they change their goals, how do you help them work towards their new goal without losing all of the data that they have. And then keeping in mind that not all lapses and abandonment are bad. I think one of the self-critiques I'll make of our field is that we treat it as a failure when people stop using a personal informatics tool a number of times, and I've had to kind of break myself of that habit too. When in fact, right, again, some of these people, it's a success, or they weren't getting any value from it anyway, so we should be celebrating that they were able to reject using it and move on. In some of our interviews and surveys, people talk about being free after they get rid of their Fitbit or something like that. The third assumption I want to talk about today is kind of one that's present in a lot of the designs for trackers that you'll see, which is that the self-monitoring, right, looking at how far along you are, and then self-regulating, so saying, okay, I need to do more, or I need to do less, and then maybe some social pressure through a leaderboard or sharing on Facebook or on Twitter, is enough to support this behavior change. Right? And I think this is something that we see in a lot of devices or the design of a lot of self-trackers until pretty recently. And you know, so you'll get the number on the device, you'll get maybe a flower. You also get this dashboard which contains a graph, so you can look back and see your history on the short term or on a longer term. You can see maybe your top badges, so you've got some little rewards built in, and your most active days, and some dashboard indicators of distance and active minutes. And you can also look at this over a longer time period, so over the last month. So you can't say to yourself, oh, today was the only day, I was just really busy, but I was active the other days. You can say, oh, well, no, I'm not really hitting my goal reliably or something like that. And you're supposed to use this, you know, you look at it a little bit earlier, and you have a reaction, but also it's not, oh gosh, I'm below where it is. It's, oh gosh, I'm below where I wanted to be. What do? I don't know how I'm going to fix this. I've got all these other things I'm supposed to do. And instead of active, we see people throw their devices in the trash or put it back in the drawer. This is another point of abandonment, right? Where it's just, you know, we're not really helping people by giving them the insight or the action that they're looking for at that time. And I think industry has tried to move past this somewhat. Moves is a commercial application that's been acquired by Facebook. And it takes your activity and also combines it with location, right? So just one additional type of data. And it will say, well, here's how you got between these different places. You can see that you went for this run from the computer science building. When you went to go get pie, you were active and you cycled. I don't know what the trade-off there is between the pie and the cycling, but you know, right? You're at least looking back and you're putting this in the context of the place. And you can look at it over time, though again, if you actually want to get any synthesis of the place, that's all lost on this longer timeline view that they give. And so we went back and looked particularly at the people who wanted to track their physical activity with the goal of behavior change and asked, well, what do you actually want to get from this, right? And sure enough, some people said the awareness of activity. And I think this is somewhere that current products do pretty well, right? You know, you've got your step count, and so long as it's an activity that they can actually track, right? They do pretty well at this. Others want to increase their motivation, and if they're socially motivated through competition with friends or a group goal, that might also be somewhere the products do pretty well. Others say they want to find patterns in their behavior, and that's where it starts to break down, where you know, beyond this timeline, this burden of synthesis is on the end user, and they struggle a bit. And then to identify opportunities for change, where it's not just, should I be better, you know, on where I am or on my activity level versus my goal, but what actually about my day or what can I rearrange to make this something that's real and achievable for me? Right, and so they ask things like, where do I eat? How can I walk more? Not just, should I walk more? How do I travel? Is there something in there that's different from what I wanted it to be? And what do my inactive days look like? And is there some way that I can redesign them? And so they want this aggregation of their data to help tell the story, but also reduction in focus that answers these questions. And so one of the things that we built to try and explore this opportunity to give people a little bit more actionable data is this idea of cuts. And so it would be a subset of your personal informatics data with a common feature. It could be sliced up by time, by visits to a particular kind of location. So tell me about my visits to restaurants. How often am I going? When am I going, something like that. Or tell me about my transit patterns. So tell me about the times when I tended to cycle. Or tell me about what I do when I have a trip of less than 2 miles. And the idea was it would enable people to query their data to ask these questions about their behavior and opportunities for change. And also identify successes or to repeat, or maybe some not so great days or choices that they would hope to avoid in the future. And these cuts were largely independent of the visualization, and they could be presented a number of ways. And I'll walk through a few of them really quickly. So this first one is a table, right? And some data is just better presented as tables. And this was someone who was curious about how much time they were spending at work. They were someone who wanted to have slightly longer weekends and to front load their work days. And so they were saying, oh, this is great. I spend a little more than 8 hours a day at work on Mondays, and that means that by Fridays I'm cutting out. And if they did the math, it wasn't quite adding up to 40 hours. But you know, they were cutting back on their Fridays and getting out early, which was consistent with their goals. And so they were looking at this pattern. This other one was someone who was looking at their travel and saying, well, I know I should walk more, I should use my car and my less, and maybe bike a little more. But how am I doing? And so they could cut up their trip by distance. So this is their trips from half a mile to a mile. And also here's from 1 mile to 3 miles. And then the colors represent their transit mode. And so the green is walking. And so the first thing this person notices is, great, for trips of less than a mile, they're almost always walking. In the, most of the other cases, they're biking, right? This is progress, right, in terms of their goals. But as soon as they go to that 1 to 3 mile range, they're not really biking. And they're not really walking as much, right? And they were like, oh, I'm surprised. I thought that I was actually walking and biking for a lot of these trips. They could click on that graph region, and it would load up the corresponding trips in a map, so they could look for some opportunities to change them and say, well, maybe there's something in here that's a routine trip, and if I could just get myself out of the habit of driving to the store where I don't really buy very much and take the bike instead, I would actually make a sustainable change, right? So they'd actually be able to inspect it with their location patterns as well. So the first is being confronted with this idea that maybe they're not really taking their bike or walking as much as they think for these short trips. And the second is, okay, well, which of these short trips might they be able to start amending to walk more? All right, this last one is a sand key diagram. And the first time the student showed it to me, I kind of said, oh, where are you going with this? And so Sankey diagrams are used to often illustrate sort of flows of people through spaces. So one area where you might see it is if you were diagramming, say, a comic and you looked at, say, the Avengers movies or the Avengers comics, and which movies are they all the characters in the same place for, and which ones do they go to separate places for, and then they come back together and things like that. So we took this idea and applied it to you, where each line represents not a separate character, but a different one of your days. And so you can see that this person's typically starting their day at home, they're typically at work in the middle of the day, and then they're typically back at home towards the end of the day. And they can see some other patterns, and then it was color-coded by the transit type that they took to get between the two. It was a lot. And it wasn't the most easy thing for people to use, so it has a lot of usability barriers with it. But people did start exploring it, saying, oh my goodness, I really do go to this place a lot, and it looks like I'm biking once they kind of got the use of it and felt good about that. I'd say, oh, why am I driving so much to there? Or, oh, I'm at home at dinner time a lot less than I am at restaurants, and I thought, you know, that I actually cook a lot, but I'm always rationalizing this way that I'm eating out or something like that. And people would start to see opportunities for change. And then we compared it to the standard moves output, which also had location and place associated with it. And so people, when they saw these cuts, would tell us things like, well, maybe on average Tuesdays I don't cycle much, maybe there's a day that I did. I could go back to that day and say, okay, what was it about that Tuesday that made it different and that maybe I could be more active? When people say I'm most active on Tuesdays, obviously there's something on Tuesdays that I should start doing on other day that's actionable data. And I think this participant actually found out that on Tuesday, when they inspected their map, they were walking across their corporate campus to another location for a lunchtime meeting. And that was all it took for them to get between where they typically were and actually being hitting their activity goal. And they stopped and said, well, actually, I like that walk, right? And the food over there is better anyway. I'm just going to try and do that every day for lunch, right, and make that as a sustainable change. We didn't follow up with them, so I don't know if it worked, but it was this idea that they could find things where they could adjust their routine, not just, oh, I better get in an extra 150 steps tonight or something like that. We also showed these cuts to some people who had lapsed in using Fitbit. So people who had given up their devices and stopped tracking and gave them these sort of retrospective views by downloading data from their accounts and say, you walked an average, you know, 5,000 steps on Sundays, what prevented you from walking more, things like that, where you zeroed in on their lower day. And you know, here's what you did in November, an average of 321 steps a day. Would you consider starting to use your Fitbit again, right, when we see this downward trend? And this is actually pretty common that as the holidays approach or as winter approaches, sedentary behavior creeps back in even when people are pretty, you know, otherwise successful. Right? And so in the first case, it was someone who said, oh yeah, there was something about Sundays that I meant to change. I didn't stick with it. Maybe I can do that. And in the second case, it was, yeah, maybe I do need some added technology help, at least in the winter or the rainy season or something like that, right? And so even though they weren't tracking anymore by pulling out their retrospective data and saying, well, maybe there's an opportunity here, they started, you know, they still found value in the cut. And so I think there's a lot of opportunity to think about what this means to present data with reduction and focus to help people answer questions, but also to still allow exploration and let people ask their own questions about themselves and find their own opportunities. Right, and so we can also take this idea that we're gonna help people reduce their attention and focus on just the data that they need at a given time and extend it to how we help people answer questions or even design the tracking process overall. And so for this work, we've worked mostly with irritable bowel syndrome, which is characterized by these episodic gastrointestinal system symptoms. It affects up to 20% of the US population, causing you know, either just bad days or missed work in more extreme cases, with potential individualized triggers, including certain nutrients, eating behaviors like do you have particularly large portions, do you eat small meals throughout the day, stress, sleep disturbance, and menstruation. And so I'll start by just sort of walking through how people try and identify their individualized triggers now. And for this, we're going to take sort of this aggregate representation of a character named Jane. She's 32 years old. She has these severe symptoms that are bad enough that they cause her to miss work sometimes. And she knows she needs help. She's you know, feels like this is out of control and doesn't have a plan. She has someone in her family who also has had similar symptoms that she knows about, so she goes to her brother and says, well, help me, what's going on with you? And he says, oh, well, I noticed that for me, I tended to get worse when I was having stress. I started exercising to manage my stress, and this was, you know, seemed to help me out. Jane says, okay, great, that's what I'm gonna do, right? It runs in the family, this must be it. And so she goes ahead and she buys a fitness band, she tracks her mood and tracks her physical activity. And she's like, okay, I'm gonna watch this, I'm gonna do better. And at the end, she's still having her symptoms. She's left with a bunch of graphs of her mood over time, her activity over time, and really no answers in here other than that things aren't getting better for her. And so she knows that she doesn't have an answer in here for what's going on, so she takes it to her doctor and says, well, maybe my doctor can help me figure out what's going on. First thing her doctor says is, well, I don't know what you want me to do. You didn't track your symptoms, right? So already she's starting with, you know, you didn't really set up your tracking right. There's some frequency issues here. And you didn't track your food, and that's the most common trigger for GI symptoms, so we're already in some trouble here. And she says, well, since it's probably food, I'm gonna put you on this elimination diet where you reduce all these categories of food from what you eat. Maybe if it works, we'll start to gradually reintroduce them and see how it goes. The diet is difficult to follow. It's often difficult to interpret because people may not have very good knowledge of what they're eating and whether it contains these problematic nutrients. It's a lengthy process, especially if you plan to gradually reintroduce to try and get back to eating a fuller range of foods. And it's quite possibly still inconclusive, especially if as you reintroduce food, some other stressors or possible triggers come into your life. And if you do go through this with a provider and you're reintroducing or you're trying to do this without the elimination diet, the current standard of care is to take a paper diary, and these are paper diaries from some of our patient participants, and bring it in to your doctor and look for correlations between what you eat and symptoms. Right? And each of these contains, you know, here's a day, right? So in order to find correlations, you have to synthesize across all these days, which means you have to keep track of this stuff for days, and you have to have a provider who's willing to work with you to do that using you know, these open-ended questions in which you're keeping track of any symptoms you have and writing in foods. And you may use a form your provider gives you or that you downloaded online, or you may use an open-ended notebook. Needless to say, this doesn't go well. We took 7 of these patient diaries and showed them to 7 different providers. If we took the same patient diary and showed it to 7 providers, we would typically get around 7 recommendations of things to cut, right? Super inconsistent interpretation of the diary. If we took the same, or if we took 7 diaries to 1 provider, that provider tended to make the same recommendation on every diary. And so what we're learning is that certain providers have this belief that there's this trigger, and so that's what they look for, right? They have this confirmation bias that they apply when they read the diary. And so the ability to solve problems with this right now is quite poor, despite, you know, honestly really good and hard work from both the provider and the patients involved. And so there's an opportunity to recast this self-tracking into hypothesis formation based on those journals, and then a more formal and rigorous testing of these hypotheses. And so I'm going to start with the hypothesis formation process. And so for this, we have them keep the same paper diary in which they're tracking their foods for a given day and they're tracking symptoms. This is the format that one of the gastroenterologists we work with likes best. And then we hire a dietitian, so there is some money that we're throwing at the problem right now. Maybe someday it'll be automated. We're not sure how possible that's going to be yet. And code it for these constituent nutrients that are likely triggers. And so they go through this conversion. And then we present these visualizations to them. And one of them, I'll walk through them each separately. One of them is a bubble and bar chart that shows the relationship between the nutrient and their corresponding symptoms, so they can look for patterns. And they can also click on regions, and it will do things like load up the corresponding meal that they ate. So the x-axis here is showing the amount of starch that they had. Y-axis is showing their symptoms. And the scatter plot shows the amount of nutrients in foods and corresponding symptoms. So there's kind of this general trend that as they eat more starch, their symptoms are becoming more severe. Okay. And again, they can click on one of these regions and it will show you that the corresponding foods and the symptoms they ate. So they're actually inspecting back to their actual diet and what was the possible trigger food. So that we're not just giving you back this advice of eat less starch, we're telling you what in your diet was high in starch. And that's particularly important if it's something that you're eating regularly and can cut back on. The second one was a little more complex. It was a parallel coordinates plot. And this one was also one where the first time the student showed it to me, I kind of said, oh, this is not going to work. There's all this work that says that, you know, most people do not have very good graphical literacy. There's no way we're going to walk people through this. And well, let's try it. See what we can find out. And so it follows a similar idea, but it's a little more open-ended. So you have your symptom, and you have all of the nutrients, and you can look for correlations between them. And you can also select particular regions, and it will load up the corresponding foods and symptoms for those data points. Okay, and then they can go back in and find their data. Okay, and so we took this back out to patients and their actual providers and gave them back their own data. And walk them through a tutorial that we built into the application. And the overall response was that they greatly preferred this analysis over the paper diaries. It reduced the burden of synthesis. Rather than flipping through pages and pages of days, you had these graphical visualizations and you could actually understand them. We compared the conclusions that they said they drew from them with the, you know, what the data actually supported, and these conclusions were reasonable, right? So they were actually able to get something from the visualizations with the tutorial. So another takeaway is that yes, graphical literacy may be a challenge, but it's not something we should just, you know, say, oh, it'll never work. I think it's an opportunity to design nice, good tutorials that will help people walk through it. One of the things that helped us here a lot was that this was their own data, so they had some sort of intuition about it, and they could see back into the data and say, yep, that was what I ate. I've got some confidence in this. At least initially, when providers and patients reviewed these separately, they had some concerns about it. So the patients weren't totally sure that the science was valid. The providers weren't totally sure that the data collection was valid. And so we put the two of them in the room afterwards, and they talked about it, and they very quickly realized as patients that they would trust the results, and the providers very quickly trusted that the patients had done a diligent job of keeping the journals. They still had really different preferences to how to use them. Some of the patients and providers thought that this is something the patient should just get at home and then call if they had a question about. Other providers were on the more extreme end of, no, I need to see it first and then I'll review it with the patient. So actually how to fit this into care is still going to be a challenge. All right. And so then the next stage here, right, is all of this still is correlational data, right? It doesn't actually show cause. If you do something like you drink a lot of coffee when you're stressed, we might come back and tell you that caffeine is a trigger, when in fact it's the stress that's triggering you. And so we needed a more formal way to test this. And so for this, we'll go back to Jane, right, who had her severe symptoms, she was missing work, and she needs help. She's gone through the diary process now, and she's come back with this conclusion that, well, she sees a correlation between lactose, caffeine, stress, and her symptoms. And so she has a little problem disambiguating this, because she drinks coffee when she's stressed, and every time she drinks coffee, she puts milk in it, right? And so it's how is she actually going to tell outside of an actual experiment, right, because it's so confounded. And so we have an app to walk her through that, which I really wanted to call Inspector Gutchit. My colleagues vetoed that, and so it's Tummy Trials. Right, and so she downloads Tummy Trials and uses it, and it walks her through this process of setting up a new trial. And the first thing that we're going to find out, again, in this idea of reduction of focus is, which are the symptoms that are actually your worst? Which are the ones that we need to track, rather than making you track all of these symptoms? So she says, well, it's abdominal pain and bloating or gas. And then we walk her through these possible common causes, and she enters that first she's going to test lactose or dairy. So then she goes through this, and it randomizes a 12-day program where she's going to, on any given day, adjust her breakfast. And so for lactose or dairy, she's going to have her usual breakfast of, you know, or a standardized breakfast that we agree on, and she's only going to vary whether it has dairy. And on days when it's non-dairy, she'll put in some sort of non-dairy alternative, like soy milk or something like that. And then she's going to eat her breakfast, she's going to record whether she complies, and then she's going to record the symptom severity afterwards, about 3 hours after. So one of the nice things about doing this with food is that for these symptoms, the effects tend to cycle pretty quickly. If you're going to feel an effect, you tend to feel it in about 3 to 4 hours, which also has this really nice benefit that means that after she's recorded her symptoms at noon or so, she can then go and eat the way that she wants to for the rest of the day. Right, so it's not too disruptive on her overall life. So she does this. It turns out that it's not lactose, and she's pretty confident it's not lactose. So she repeats it with caffeine and finds that, sure enough, if she does this with caffeine, she sees a difference between days when she has caffeine and not in the visualization we include. We also include a summary based on a statistical analysis. So it says there's, this is actually a beta that isn't quite right. So it says there's no evidence. In this case, assume there was evidence. She says, okay, I'm going to cut back on the caffeine. However, remember that she was having the caffeine when she was stressed, right? So we need a plan for her. And so here, too, in this case, she's going to go into her doctor and talk about it and says, well, I'm stressed and I'm drinking a lot of caffeine. It turns out I need to cut back on this. What do I do? Doctor talks about some sleep hygiene programs with her, and maybe they come up with a plan to get her onto a little more stress management and a little better sleep so that she can cut back on the caffeine. And so we've just completed a 15-person, well, just as in, I guess, September, but it's coming up at Chi, so it still feels like recent, 15-person field study on this. And overall, participants reported really low burden with this. They found that this was much easier to integrate into their lives than the elimination diet or other things they'd tried to figure out their triggers. They had really high completion rates. Basically, everyone except one person completed it. And they found the results valuable, so they really liked having a controlled experiment because it felt like, to them, they knew they were doing it right. They relied on the visual analysis much more than the statistical analysis. There's some problems with the statistical analysis we did. It's very frequentist-based, and we should be switching our framework to more Bayesian, and so we're working on changing that now to something that gives people a little more actionable kind of claims, like, well, if you eat this, your symptoms will increase by this much, or something like that. The other thing that came up in all this was that they were willing to accept and act on rigor much less than like our P of 0.05 that we may become accustomed to in experimental design. Because for them, it's their life, and if it didn't work out, they could just go back and change it, right? They're not making some generalized claim, they're just making choice about what to eat for breakfast. And so they're willing to accept somewhat less rigor. The other interesting thing that came out of it was that life intervenes a lot in this. So I mentioned earlier that we were modifying their breakfast in this study. And that's actually a pretty easy meal because often people are pretty consistent across their breakfast. And then there's brunch, right? And so people had some problems on weekends where it interfered with their social lives. 12 days was nice because it only meant that it interfered with one weekend if they started on a Monday. but it still wasn't, you know, perfect, and so people would make some interesting choices around brunches. Other people would actually bring their breakfast to the restaurant and say, I'm doing the study, look at this app. And the restaurant was like, oh, okay, fine. You know, so they found actually that once they talked about it with people, they did get some support. Other people ran into issues like oversleeping and wondered how they should adjust their experiment. Most of them made the actually correct and reasonable choice of if they ate breakfast 3 hours late, they could just go ahead and record their symptoms 3 hours late. And so long as they didn't have lunch until after they'd done that, they were good to go and the experiment was still valid. So in many cases, they had a good model of the scientific experiment we were doing. In other cases, it needed a little more work so they could figure out how to adjust for glitches that came along. All right, so that's the one opportunity to recast self-tracking, especially if you're trying to do one of these diagnostic approaches. We've done it with food, and I feel good enough about the results of the Tummy Trials app that if we had the resources and a little more design effort to expand out the number of foods, I'd feel comfortable releasing that in the App Store tomorrow and we wouldn't be misleading anyone. For things where there's spillover effects like sleep or migraines, because I know some of you are working on that, that's going to be a lot harder. And so getting beyond these kind of short-term food triggers is still a huge research challenge and opportunity. All right, so the other thing that comes out of this as an opportunity is giving them scaffolding, right? So a lot of people, right, we can't necessarily expect everyone to be an armchair data scientist, right? Or that even if they want to go the route of being an armchair data scientist, that we need to give them some scaffolding so that they actually make a reasonably informed choice about how to set up their tracking in a way that's going to fit into their life, but also give them really valid results. And so I've already talked a little bit about this in the reduction and focus point, but one of the other assumptions that I think comes up in a lot of self-tracking practices and design of tools is that more data are better. And we've kind of reached a pretty extreme point here where that Omron pedometer has become a Fitbit that now tracks your heart rate as well. You can throw in your location from your phone. We can take a wirelessly connected scale and take that, or just have people record it. You can take credit card histories or shopping loyalty card histories. Using your location, we can load up the weather. We can also take your calendar data. And though it's still really high burden, we can ask people to log their food. And I think Kirk Simon's quote actually applies really nicely here, right? You know, so the wealth of information creates a poverty of attention, right? And so that, you know, needing to allocate your attention now creates this overabundance of information sources and reduces your ability to pay attention to it. I actually like another quote from Margaret Mead a little better on this one, which is that unanalyzed data are worse than no data. And she's actually talking about herself as a researcher here, right? And maybe some of you have all felt this pain too of, oh, I collected this data and I don't think it's going anywhere. I don't know what my plan was and what am I going to do with it? Turns out self-trackers feel the same thing, right? And collecting all of this from many people now makes them feel like, gosh, I really ought to be living the perfect, optimally healthy and well life because I've got all this data. Yay. And instead it makes them feel guilty, right, that they haven't figured out the answer in all of this, right? Or seeing their Fitbit data saying they're constantly not hitting their goal but not knowing how to make a plan to address it leaves them better off. Or more simply put, it's a data fetish. So one of the things that we've worked on here is that food diaries are a place where it's pretty data heavy, and the trend of design has been to give you very rich data, how many calories in it, what nutrients are in everything you eat, and so on. And so some work that others at UW have done have pointed out that food journals are also very high burden. I don't know if any of you have ever tried keeping a full food diary, but it's hard, right? And it's hard to do on your own. It's even harder if you have a social life and you go to like dinners with other people or a buffet, right? You know, it's very quickly impossible to actually keep a good and accurate record. They also can feel really judgy, especially as you're approaching whatever your calorie limit is for that day. You'll see people do things like actually choose not to enter a food because they know it's going to make them go over their diet and they don't want to feel bad, right? And so they'll hoard these entries and then maybe they'll put something else in that day. But you know, you're starting to get missing data, despite this idea, you know, this ideal that this is a complete and perfect record. And they can also nudge people to eat things that are easier to log, right? So if you have a choice between logging a Hungry Man meal that has a barcode on it that you can just scan, or a home-cooked meal, this takes about 5 seconds. Your home cooked meal could take, you know, if you're going to be diligent about it, 30 minutes to log, right? And so it starts pushing people towards these processed and packaged foods, which are exactly not the thing they should be eating in most cases. It's also really, really different from how most of us think about food, right? We don't really think about a spreadsheet usually when we start thinking about our meals or your lunch today. Often it's social, often we think about the flavors or the enjoyment of it. We think about cravings. We're not really thinking about, well, I'm gonna enter this as, you know, is it half a piece of iceberg lettuce or a full piece of iceberg lettuce, right? And so it's pretty inconsistent with how I think people think of food. And so in one of our projects, we've drawn on the idea of celebratory technology from Andrea Grimes, which is, you know, right, that all this judgy, prescriptive things that we're doing and tracking can actually sort of really take away from people's overall well-being, even if they're optimizing for that one data point. Right, and so started saying, well, is there an opportunity, at least for some healthy eating goals, to do better for people? And so we took some work that some others at UW had been doing on photo-based food journals, and they actually turn out to be pretty nice because they're low burden. You just take a picture. Some people love Instagramming their food already, so right, it's something that people are getting used to doing or seeing other people doing, so it's not even as socially awkward as asking someone everything that's in a food. And it turns out they have a lot less of these negative nudges. If you miss a measurement, no big deal. There's also no budget in your photos, so if you take a picture of something, you don't necessarily feel as terrible when you add it to your record. And this follows this idea, right, that there's this trade-off between effort and utility in a lot of cases. And in a lot of cases, we've been pushing on this idea of difficult things to do that are high utility in self-tracking, right? So we just keep adding more data and adding more work to it, and you'll, you know, data science it and figure it out. And in reality, we're actually still more like down here, where we think we're doing high utility, but we're just doing a lot of effort and not getting you a lot of the value yet. Right? And so there's a need, you know, and we saw this in some of our IBS work, of where it is something where you do need all that data to take that paper diary and move its utility out by analyzing it in better ways or recasting the process. And also other ways to slightly lower the effort, and you see that with some of the diary apps out there. But really, we have this opportunity to be pushing on this whole end of the curve. And so these photo-based food diaries are down here where the utility is certainly lower, especially if you're on a particular budget, but they're a heck of a lot easier. And so if you don't need that full detailed calorie budget, maybe this is a way to go. And so we built an app that tried to further even lower the budget. So rather than having you take a picture of everything you eat, what if we just give you one challenge a day, right? One thing that you're supposed to eat a day and see how you do on it. And so this could be things like eat something that's good for your eyes, eat something that contains no carbs, eat something cooked in a healthy oil. And the idea behind this was that being mindful of what you eat is actually one of the best predictors for healthy eating, including managing things like eating disorders or also just eating more whole and more fresh foods. And so rather than putting you on a budget, we're just gonna try and make you more mindful of your diet. And we tried four versions of this. So there were two versions of the challenges. One was nutritionally prescriptive, so like the things you saw on the previous page of eat something good for your eyes. And others were these non-nutrition challenges. And then we had a version of it where they could post their result to Facebook in a Facebook group with other people in that same position, and a version where they just did this privately for themselves. And so for these nutrition challenges, like I said, they do something like eat something high in fiber, eat something with at least 20 grams of protein, or that eat something good for your eyes challenge. And that might require you to actually go out and look up, what is good for my eyes? I don't know, right? And so we would encourage some learning too. But we were still worried that this might appear a little judgy or prescriptive, right? And not necessarily how people think of when they eat food. So we also tried some other variations, these non-nutritional challenges, that were a little more whimsical or creative. So eat something yellow. Eat something an elephant would eat. And yeah, we're still sending you out to Wikipedia or whatever, but now you're going, what does an elephant eat? Not what's good for my eyes. Or eat something that reminds you of your high school years, and yeah, a lot of people ate tater tots for this or tried to, right? And that's fine, right? It's maybe not the healthiest choice, but again, they're a little more mindful of what they're eating. And so in the Facebook group, this would appear in a challenge. This was someone to eat something that starts with the letter A. there were a lot of pictures of arugula and apples, right? And here someone's actually like, hey, this is great. This wasn't another apple picture. This was something a little different, right? And getting some variety. And that was also good for the things like, what would an elephant eat? You could also learn some things about elephants through what others posted. Other people enjoyed reminiscing about the high school challenges and things like that. Okay. And so kind of rough high-level findings from it were the nutrition challenges had somewhat higher engagement, right? People treated this as a food exercise or app. And so this one had a little more purpose to the activity of if it's pushing you towards healthy things, but they certainly felt more judgy to people. The non-nutrition challenges actually resulted in greater gains in food mindfulness, even though they didn't do as many of them, right? Perhaps because people were actually willing to think about it throughout the day. I'm not totally sure why. On the other hand, because it didn't have this clear purpose, the challenges and the activities felt a little more arbitrary. And in the social features, they completed more challenges, but they were also less likely to use the app to record other foods throughout the day because, you know, they met their social challenge and they were kind of done with it for the day. There's this interesting interaction effect where people in the social condition completed more challenges than the non-social, but the effect sort of flipped. You know, so there's not really an effect in the social, in the difference between nutrition and non-nutrition, but in the nutrition, non-social was way more effective than the non-nutrition, non-social, because in this case, the people were really like, what's the point? Why am I privately recording, you know, these answers to these challenges? But just adding the social version onto it made it a lot more fun and gave that a meaning and a purpose. So I think there's also an opportunity here to think about what is the minimum viable data and the minimum viable activity for someone, right? Or what do you actually need to do to provide the experience you want? And so before we jump right to the full food journal solution, are there opportunities just to design experiences for people who want to eat a little healthier and to be a little more mindful of their food? And also to design for experiences around it, not just hoarding and collecting and analyzing data. And then finally, there's this assumption that this is self-tracking. And it's not, right? So we saw in Jane's case, and we've seen in the IBS case, that people are taking the data to their doctors now. They're bringing in their paper diaries, and it's not going well. They're bringing in 5 years of printed Fitbit graphs to their doctors, and that's really not going well, right? Because they're like, well, what do you want from me? And my guess is if you've got 5 years of Fitbit data here, that actually the problem is somewhere else. On the other hand, we also see this huge effort from a lot of providers to use it. They'll ask people to keep track of their heart rate or other things like that. So there's recognition from both patients and providers that there's value in this data for treatment plans or for accountability or motivation, but they're not there. And I'm not going to talk a lot about it today, but I do think that thinking about that this data is not just for that person, but they're using it with others, and that they have to share it with others in some cases to get the value is going to help the design of these tools a lot better. I know Gina was here last week, I think, and
she got canceled.
Oh, she got canceled. Well, would have been here last week, does a lot of work on social media, right? And people also engage their peers in support networks, and we saw in the food for thought with those daily challenges that the social helped give the activity a little more meaning and make it more fun for people. And I'm happy to talk a lot more about that during the reception or Q&A too. Right, but overall, we've got to remember when we design these tools and study them, people are enlisting their peers, family, and friends, and experts for help, whether or not we design the tools for that sharing. And so if we think about designing the tools for that kind of sharing, we're going to help people get more value out of it. And also remember that families track together, right? So if you're in a family, the people you cohabitate with hugely influence your sleep patterns, what you eat. If you're a kid, right, they're mandating what you eat in your sleep patterns in some cases, or coercing, right? And so there's lots of opportunities here. And so this model is really good for data dependency, but I think if we move to thinking about it as just sort of something that happens in this larger scheme of, you know, people choosing to track, selecting the right tool for them, you know, and right now that happens in the app store, word of mouth, or a doctor's recommendation. They do that tracking, they lapse, they might come back to the same tool, they might say, oh, this isn't it, and they might, you know, re-enter later. But it's an ongoing cycle and not something you can just expect people. They come to it with a lot of different goals, and that there's a lot of opportunity to design for these different goals and use patterns. We need to design for these lapses, and not all of those lapses are bad. Right? And there's this whole opportunity or whole spectrum of opportunities along this curve, including very low effort activities and very high effort activities. Tracking can be high burden, and so helping people reduce and focus and get value out of it commensurate with the burden they put into it or the effort they put into it is important. And then it's also about the experiences people have with it, not just the data. We're not going to turn everyone into a little scientist at home. And that self-tracking rarely is truly self-tracking. At that, I just want to say thank you, and also a huge thanks to many of the collaborators on this. These have all taken a lot of people to work on, especially some PhD students who have led all of these projects over the years. Thanks.
Thanks a lot for this. I wanted to push or ask a little more about that relationship to healthcare providers. Because it's often struck me in some of the stuff I've sort of read around, like the quantified self movement, which is not quite the same as this, but you know, is that at least at the more extreme ends of that, there's actually a sort of strong opposition to traditional healthcare and the things that you can expect healthcare providers to provide for you. And actually, the quantification is also is often like, well, my doctor's never going to do this, and so I'll have to do this, right? You need to do it yourself. And so I'm interested in where in the tensions around, you know, sort of alluded to yourself, also people just bringing enormous amounts of data. How does this look from the healthcare provider's side?
Yeah, it varies. There's certainly some people who roll their eyes when patients come in with this data. Unfortunately, I think in a lot of cases, they treat it as someone who needs more attention and not necessarily needs actually more healthcare. And that's probably true in some cases, but it's unfortunately become the stereotype for some providers. The other point that I want to pick up on is that my doctor is not going to do this, right? And I think in many cases that is completely true because the tools right now for a doctor to do that are completely inadequate, right? These are quantified selfers who are building their own custom tools, their own custom spreadsheets to analyze data, if they do the paper diary. We've had a doctor talk about, well, I will flip through that and I will find the first thing that is a possible trigger in there and I'll tell them to cut it out and then if they come back, we'll do it again, right? And they're doing it because they only have 3 to 5 minutes in a visit to deal with this or something like that. And so I think that if we get better tools, we're going to lower the threshold for providers to do this. We're also going to raise the ceiling, you know, in terms of what people can do and what kind of value they can get out of it. But yeah, they're all over the map in terms of their reactions right now.
Well, a question on the limits of information visualization for self-discovery. Yeah. I mean, information visualizations are not intuitive, typically. Parallel coordinates, you don't understand them unless you took an information visualization class. In cases where there is a larger known number of factors that may cause symptoms, wouldn't it be better to have more passive approach where statistical analysis is being done on the user's data and that results are being presented to users rather than users have to form their own hypotheses based on visualizations that are difficult to understand once you get more complex data?
Yes,
I accept visualizations for a small set of data by all means.
Yeah.
But there's an interesting correlation between statistical analysis, Bayesian machine learning approaches, and visualization that could be explored here.
Yeah, so I think there's kind of a couple of questions in that. One is, you know, can we do more passive collection analysis overall and just come back with conclusions? And then should those conclusions be presented visually or not? I think the passive case is great for coming up with initial analyses and likely candidates. I do think that, you know, as we saw in the case of Jane, which is actually pretty common, that they'll come back with something that's confounded. Or worse, they will have only had access to one kind of the data, like they'll have had access to her food but not her stress. And so they'll come back with a very strong conclusion when in fact there's some confounding thing that wasn't measured. And so I do think that active is going to be important for testing things, especially so that people can actually be empowered to make, you know, to know if this is a good conclusion rather than just do what the system tells them to cut out or add in. The other question is on visuals. I was, when I started this, a lot more skeptical on visualization than I am now. I'd read a bunch of the work on people, right, not being graphically literate. I've seen it work enough times now with good tutorials that I think that sometimes it's an answer. The other, but I don't think it's the only answer. I think that caption, you know, these text summaries can also be valuable. A lot of the text summaries right now do a statistically significant correlation, or they don't present any uncertainty. Like, if you do this, this is the relationship. And one of my other big beliefs in this space is that there's a huge need to help people understand the uncertainty behind the data, right? So how certain is this recommendation? What's the range of possible outcomes in terms of my symptoms if I eat this food right now? I think visualizations are somewhere where we've explored that more as a field and how to present that uncertainty rather than in text, where I'm not too sure that we're very, you know, I know that we've done some work on exploring the text summaries. I think there's also going to be a lot of value in this combination of a text, here's what we think is going on, and here's the visualization that helps you explore that data underneath it. But again, I don't think we can just hand the visualization over without a good tutorial or scaffolding around how people should use or understand it. Yeah, Gary.
Is there other opportunities here for rolling up data across people? I'm thinking that, you know, like your little experiment on the irritable bowel syndrome stuff, I mean, a sample of one, there's all kinds of things that could mess that up.
Yeah.
So, but if you could aggregate this stuff in some way, you might see patterns that, you know, that would convince all the people that there's something going on here that they could pay attention to.
Yeah, so can we roll it up? And I think that's absolutely going to be one of the next steps. I think one of the reasons I'm so eager to get the self-experimentation work out in the world, especially on the food trials, is that even if, you know, so if we release this tomorrow to 1,000 people, hypothetically, maybe we had some good PR, we would get a much better understanding of what are the first foods that you should test, right? Because right now they're actually, only this last year was that huge elimination diet that's been around for like 10 years actually been shown to work in the US population, because that's, you know, standard RCT and timeline. But rolling that up, I mean, now we actually get to, this is the most likely one, here's some clusters, right? If this is a known trigger for you, here's some other ones that you should probably test because we found clusters. There's also, I think, a possibility to link this up with something like sequencing your microbiome. So that now if someone goes and gets sequenced and it just tells them based on all the work there. So it's also a research tool. But I also think that it's important that we start with the value for one person. I think it's hard for people to be motivated to even change their breakfast if it's going to help the population, but they don't get immediate value. But yeah, totally. Aggregating this data is going to be, I think, a huge next step, or maybe a couple steps down the road.
So you had mentioned the photographic as being an easy way. There's work being done in Scripps and also a couple other apps that actually have a photograph. And maybe you know about this, right? It goes back to a database and you kind of tweak it, and over time it learns and it gets better and better. You just have to take a photograph and it'll assign a calorie amount.
Yeah, and we've been talking to some folks in Seattle who are also, I don't think they're attached to exactly that project, but another one. I'm pretty confident that that's still a while out from being good. I'm excited that it will probably someday be good. I'm interested in kind of the question of what can we do now just from reviewing it as a mosaic. And the mosaic's enough that even you notice things like, oh, I don't need anything green, right? And people will pick up on things that are, oh, all of my salads are white because I put on so much ranch, right? And we'll hear things like that. Yeah, we've got some ranch lovers in the audience. But, right, it's, and so I am curious on how we can do with just the photos. I do think that this opportunity to connect it to a diary, we're actually doing another study in a couple of months where people, where nutritionists try and code the photos to see how that turns out. At first, they were, you know, when we first started this conversation a year ago, they spoke with us like we were asking the impossible. Now we've kind of reached an understanding that, well, we'll see just how good it is or how bad it is. I think that once that gets there, there's this other huge challenge of when do you show it to people, right? If someone is just trying to eat a little healthier, do they need that calorie budget data? Does it become this burden for them? Does it make them hate using the app because it gives them the summary? And that's going to be an interesting challenge where it's like free to add, you know, or at least very low cost, but may not actually be good for every user.
So at Scripps, they had a lot of grad students who used it, and they found out that like 40% or 50% of their calories were after 6 o'clock in the evening, and were like having a beer and then eating and whatnot, and that was
Right, so these sort of time heat maps of, right, like, oh, I just need to, I think that's another one where there's an opportunity to change your routine of, like, okay, I'm not going to try and eat every meal less healthy, but I am going to not have second dinner, right?
Right,
Yeah, Matt.
Can you say, so you've talked about lapsing sort of in that large, abandoning a particular device temporarily.
Yeah.
But there was, at one point you mentioned also kind of a shorter term, like lapse in actual data collection. Like, and one of the things that I've seen in some of the stuff that we've been doing is that those lapses are often not random.
Yeah.
That they are, I'm not feeling well today, so I'm not going to put on my pedometer.
Yeah.
Something like that. How do you deal with the, you know, when you're thinking about these kinds of things, how do you deal with no data?
Yeah, right now we aren't dealing with it, just to be honest. I do think that letting people make a note about that is good. I think it will be important for people to go back and look at their notes to see how they're rationalizing maybe no data every time. I do think that no data, at least when we've looked, and we haven't done a lot of the quantitative look at what people do over time and use patterns, but we've looked at some people's Fitbit profiles, and often what you'll see is no data, no data, no data, data again, right? And then it becomes these sort of larger lapses where there's often a pattern, right? And it's often a sign that that tool is just not working for them in some way. You know, I think, right, like if, I wonder, if, you know, for the I'm not feeling well, so I'm not going to wear it crowd, I'm wondering if instead at that time, if there's some other messaging, like they could put their Fitbit into sick mode, right? Like, you know, and something else where it's acknowledging that their situation and their goal is not the same, right? I think some of what you're seeing there is this inflexibility in goals in the design, where when you're sick, your goal is not to hit 10,000 steps, probably. It's probably to not feel awful, right? Or to get through the day. And so again, I think a lot of it will come back to like goal flexibility.
They're taking notes. Okay. So very interesting talk, and I assume many of you have further questions. Let's move downstairs. We have a social hour there, and we can keep talking with, keep our discussion with Sean.
Thanks.